Okay, magandang araw kapamilya. Welcome to Journeys of Hope. Just like I mentioned earlier, sabi ko this next two weekends, this is the second to the last weekend before the elections, we're going to talk about how people journeyed through their choices, no? For this coming election. So, we're very grateful that my team in Proyekto Pilipino is joining us this weekend. We have of course Manolo Quezon, the explainer. We have Carlo Santiago and Dr. Leloy Claudio from Proyekto Pilipino. Okay, guys, ano ba yung journey natin ng pagpili natin ng ating kandida without naming who you're voting for? But what were the things that came into play when you made your choice? Sa pag-discern nyo, pag-iisip ninyo?
Well, fan sa akin, it starts with something the most basic of all, which is the understanding na kailangan kong punuin ang lahat ng mga blanko. I really believe that I'm against yung leaving blanks. So, talagang feeling ko may obligation tayo na dahil may mga posisyon na talagang kailangan pagpilian, kailangan punuin yung mga yon. Otherwise, it abandons that space to someone else. Okay, so mas mahirap yon. Second of all, kailangan din yung konting pag-aaral kung ano ba yung ginagawa nung position na yon, kasi kailangan hiyang yung tao na yon sa position na pinagpipilian mo. So iba ang batayan para sa pangulo at vice presidente, sa senador, congressman, and party list and so on. Inuuna ko ang lokal dahil in many ways madaling kalimutan yon, and so talagang kailangan pag-isipan na agad. And so I guess method yon sa akin. It's basically I look for those who have demonstrated courage. I think courage is very important. The courage to think for themselves, na hindi kaladkarin at sunod na lang sunod sa utos o nagmamando na mula sa itaas, sa kaliwa, sa kanan, o sa kung saan man. So kailangan, they have the courage of their convictions. They have taken a stand that I feel is important on whatever issue, di ba? And also, finally, someone who has demonstrated a certain amount of integrity, because they're expected to wield power and spend our money. So kailangan on those two scores, medyo dapat wala masyadong issues sa kanila. That's my starting point.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, Carlo.
Sa akin, Father Tito, there were three things that I was thinking about leading to this elections. For the past 6 years since the last elections, the one, you can't escape the fact that the pandemic. Second, yung issue natin with, because of my background sa foreign policy, yung issue natin with China, and the other one being a student of history, yung appreciation of a wider view, wider view. So one, this made me think of one, empathy, because for the past 6 years, meron nga tayo nagkaroon na drug war, no? And very, very, very critical sa akin yung empathy, meaning you putting yourself in another person's shoes, because for you to be a leader, it's not possible to experience everything, to know everything, but you just have to have that level of empathy na ano ba yung nangyayari sa dito, anong nangyayari dito, anong pwede kong gawin bilang isang leader ng bansa. Second, well, action. I'm looking for someone who's action driven, because during the pandemic, hindi tayo pwedeng mahina yung observe lang. Kailangan natin kumilos eh. So the whole time, under the 2-3 years that we're in the pandemic, the things I've been looking at, sino yung mabilis kumilos, sino yung nag-aaral ng science behind the issues, after listening to the experts, sino yung nagagalvanize ng ibang tao towards action. And the last one, the one I was which combines me being a student of history and being part of the foreign policy establishment, is yung relationship natin with China, because this is a very critical issue. And if medyo malalim tong issue na to, so ayoko nang puntahan to, but safe to say
pwede natin balikan mamaya.
Pwede natin balikan yan. Pero short of war, the first thing that comes to mind when I'm trying to explain this to people who don't have a background, food security. Kasi yung we're an archipelagic nation and we should be able to harvest the bounty of the seas around us, and our current relationship with China puts the Philippines in a very precarious situation. So yun ang hinahanap ko, sino nakakaintindi ng relasyon natin with China and other countries, and sino yung magkakaroon ng informed decision towards a resolution.
Ako sa agree din ako sa iyo, Carlo, napaka-importante nung China, because China is the greatest global threat to democracy around now. Kita mo naman yung ginagawa nila sa kanilang bansa, yung lockdown for example sa Shanghai ngayon na unreasonable, na hindi ka man makapunta sa sariling balcony mo. Yung ginagawa nila sa Xinjiang province where there are practically concentration camps. So kailangan critical tayo dito, because yung pagiging critical mo sa China is also an indicator of how much you believe in democracy, not just in the Philippines but also globally. For me, yung naging isa ko pang assessment for this election is yung naratibo. Ano ba yung naratibo na dinadala ng kandidato? And the narrative that I hate is yung narrative ng strength or yung lakas, o yung narrative ng which is associated with the narrative of machismo. Ayoko na ng macho sa politika. Gusto ko yung mahinahon, mabait, nakikinig. Hindi porket mahinahon, mabait at nakikinig, ibig sabihin weakling ka na. Ibig sabihin lang nun, democratic ka na, because usually yung narrative ng lakas is ginagamit natin yun para sabihin gusto natin ng diktador eh, or naniniwala tayo sa diktador from a different period. At sawan-sawa na ako dito sa naratibo ng lakas. Yung naging mahirap for me, Father, this election, yung Senate, kasi sa Senate meron ako mga, ang pinag-isipan ko doon is, boboto ba ako ng kandidato na hindi ako naniniwala sa plataforma nila, pero malinis sila? Or vice versa, boboto ba ako ng kandidato na medyo hindi ganun kamalinis in my perception, pero akma yung plataforma niya para sa akin? Doon ako nahirapan this election.
Okay.
Meron ba sa inyong gumagawa ng straight ticket voting, na basta merong kung ano yung partido o koalisyon ng top of the ticket ninyo, yun na rin yung boboto nyo all the way down the line?
Ako hindi. Tapos ko yung baloto ko, Manolo, kasi overseas voter ako. So, pinag-isipan ko yung posibilidad na yun, pero it ended up hindi.
Bakit? For a while, I thought I was going to do that, but I'm just in the process of doing that. But I agree with you, Manolo, yung punuin lahat. Ako, I agree with that. Kailangan punuin lahat.
But I started, Manolo, with using the party that I support as a guideline. So, sino yung in-endorse sila, ayun yung unang tingnan ko. Tapos, ito madalas nating theme sa Proyekto Pilipino. Sabi nga ni Leloy, do your homework. So, when they came out with their list of candidates, pinag-aralan ko. Tapos, eventually, may nakita ko, ay, hindi pala ako sangayan sa politika nito. Yeah. So, I would take them out. But definitely, hindi ako influenced. Great. I take inspiration from it, but I'm not wholly influenced.
Yeah. And ako, ano rin eh. Let me share this with you. Last week, I'm supporting this volunteer group na nangangampanya for a candidate, no? And I'm not supporting them simply because they're campaigning for this candidate. Youth group to eh. Kasi ako, my biggest guide in making my choices, not just in politics but in my work as a priest, is securing the future for the youth. That's for me, that's number one. As best as I can, how can I help the youth of our country, especially yung mga hindi kaya mag-Ateneo or Letran or Lasal? How can I somehow contribute to give them a better chance, no? Alam nyo, nung we had this parang cheer rally for them, kasi and we had around 200 from around 10 cities around Metro Manila. And then some came from Tarlac, Pampanga, Cavite. Laguna. I'm not sure kung may Batang. But then merong iba joined us in Butuan, in Iligan, in Bicol, in the Visayas via Zoom, ano? Pero alam nyo, nung ini-interview sila ng mga MC, nandun si Robbie Domingo, and then to stream, ano ba tawag doon? Live streamers ba tawag doon? Yung live stream. Ano man ang tawag na ano, no? But you know, grabe yung mga bata. Ang linaw nila kung bakit sila active. Ang linaw nila. And alam mo, wala yung galit, wala yung pag-idolize lang doon sa tao na sinusuportahan nila. But very clear yung kanilang why they're doing it. Ano? Kaya nga sabi ko doon sa team na nag-organize, kasi yung project na yon, we did it in around 3 weeks, pero ang gulo-gulo. Up to the last few days before the project, gustong palitan ng isang grupo, ganun-ganun. So ako naman, at the end, kasi I needed to make the hard calls and decisions. Ano? Nung gabi yon, sinasabi ko nga doon sa mga katrabaho, sabi ko, you know what? It was worth all the trouble that we went through. No? For me, number one sa akin yon eh. Yung how do you secure the future for the youth? No? And hopefully, itong youth volunteerism na lumabas sa election na ito, I hope magtuloy.
Yeah.
I hope magtuloy. Alam mo, if only for this, for me, this is a major victory already. No? If we can sustain the interest of the youth in this exercise, and if we can guide them, ako, victory na yon eh. Malaking bagay sa akin yon. So,
para sa akin, yung isang bagay na mahalaga din is yung, ano yung hindi lang yung pananaw, but yung ugali nung kandidato pagdating sa kapangyarihan. So for example, one fundamental question I always look at is, sa pananaw ba nila ang kapangyarihan ay ginagamit upang gantihan ang mga hinanakit ng nakaraan? In which case, chances are, pag nagkaroon na sila ng kapangyarihan, magiging abusado sila. Because it's coming from a position of vengeance. Eh. Instead of justice, I think there's a big difference.
Yeah.
And also, if on the other hand, their approach is collective or cooperative, that everyone has something to contribute and something to do for the whole, I am more inclined to vote for that candidate than one who will say, kandidato ako ng ganitong grupo o ganyang hanay, at pag nanalo tayo mag, di ba, ang pananaw natin ng iral. I think that's fundamentally very dangerous.
Yeah.
One thing that I found really refreshing in this elections, yung debates. And to stress the importance of debates in a democracy, kasi doon lumalabas yung character ng individual, as opposed to press an interview or a press release. Iba yung debate, kasi doon mo makita yung tunay na karakter ng isang tao. And like what Manolo said, our politicians are given so much power. And this is why character is such an important thing, because character determines what they do with that power. And sa akin, tuwan-tuwa ako nung I have to give credit to Comelec, that the debates that they've
organized, people,
or they've organized, was very eye-opening. And dahil sa mga debate na nakita ko, I think I added at least 2 candidates and I took out a couple. It's very, people who say salita lang yan, words lang yan, it does make a difference.
Politics kasi is words din eh. Yung mensahe mo, yung naratibo mo, gaya na nabanggit ko, yung legislation mo, but words din yun, words that become reality. So in many ways, yung legislation is yung word made flesh ng politics. Diba? So important din how you choose and select your words. Father, kayo, anong pinaka-importante sa inyo, if I may ask you a question on your own show?
Pinaka-importante sa akin sa pagpili?
Yeah.
Ako sa akin, aside from who will protect the future of the youth? Who will stand up for the truth? Kasi ang laking problema nun eh, yung fake news. For me, I think it's more insidious than we think it is. I don't know if I mentioned to you that have you read that book by the one who does the used to be the head of the New York Times book review, Kakutani, Michiko Kakutani. She wrote a book around 3-4 years ago, The Death of Truth in the US. And it's very much what's happening to us now, no? And for me, that's a major moral issue. Ah. That's a major moral issue, yung fake news. For me, ang laking bagay na nag-ano sa akin noon eh. Na, ang laking bagay na nagtulak sa akin to come out more openly in supporting a candidate. Because I felt in peril talaga yung katotohanan eh. Because of the fake news, no? And for me,
so automatically, that takes out of consideration malaking hanay ng mga gumagamit ng
fake news.
Fake news, yeah. or are trying to strike some sort of weird middle ground na, well, alam mo, opinion lang naman yan.
Yung mga who muddles up the truth, di ba? Meron talagang sinungali at meron naman ginugulo lang ang katotohanan, di ba? So, ako yun, Leloy, those are two important things for me.
Sino bakit yung... wala sa atin ang nagbanggit ng plataporma?
ako Manolo, pinag-iisipan ko yung plataforma dun sa Senado, pero yun nga naisip ko, para ang dami rin kasing sa Senate, ang dami rin kasing kadire eh. Yung pang alam mo talagang sinungaling, alam mo talagang magnanakaw, napakalinaw ng track record, na-file na ng kaso. Ang hirap na mag-isip ng plataforma. Alam ko, I know this is a problem for a lot of Filipino voters that it's so hard to get into the platform to begin with because you're just looking at these people and yung moral character nila, even if they have the most perfect platform in the world, napakasakit iboto. And that is, I don't think we'll ever resolve that problem in Philippine politics, but it was something I felt I had to grapple with more acutely.
Leloy, the flip side of that is what about winnability? Na there are good candidates, yung intrinsically yung good people, qualified people, but will never win in science fiction. Would you vote for them?
Sa Senate, I'm more willing to do that. Sa higher positions, president tsaka vice president, I always vote strategically and I always have.
Yeah. Ikaw, yeah, I agree with Leloy na ano, well, I guess lahat naman ng boto natin to a certain extent is a principled choice, ano.
I've never voted for a winning president.
So, Carlo, can I tell you who to vote for? Pwede ba?
And sa akin, for when it comes to things like the presidency, it always usually boils down to a clear choice. Even though we have a multi-party system, I always think it always boils down to there are two main competitors. So doon medyo talagang pipili ka. Sa Senate, as Leloy said, you have 12 eh. And you know, the surveys tell us that really most people can decide on 8. Tapos yung 4 parang bahala na. I do think there is freedom to vote in a sense very, very optimistically, and so you can vote for the impossible dreamers there as well.
Yeah. But I agree with Lelo eh, di ba? Yung ano nga eh, yung character din ang pinagtatakahan mo sa Senate eh, di ba? Na there's certain things that parang you draw the line eh, di ba? Ito, I will not cross this line, di ba? Iba pagbibigyan mo pa, no? But for example, issues of corruption, for me that's number one, diba? So okay, so going to local now, going to local elections, what has guided you in terms of ano, in terms of I remember in one of our conversations in our other shows of Proyekto Pilipino, Carlo mentioned na hindi niya kilala yung kanyang mga local government officials kasi parang mas concerned siya about Manila Kasi Carlo, suburbs, di ba?
But yeah. I think yung consensus natin is because of the pandemic, talaga naging malinaw
yes.
para sa marami ang batayan nila for local.
Now that you mentioned, if I may backtrack a little bit, that would be my third point in terms of choosing the, especially the president, who would be the best leader to lead us out of a pandemic and to rebuild. To rebuild, no, from post-pandemic era. So for me, that's a major factor also, no. So in a sense, kagaya nga ng sinabi ni Carlo, because he was the one who emphasized the pandemic, sino yung gumamit ng siyensya? Sino yung merong rhyme or reason yung pagkilos, di ba, sa pandemya? So I think that's very important, no? Especially in president, kasi, di ba, we all know the immense powers of the office of the president and the resources really is controlled by the president. So saka mahalaga yun, yung susunod na presidente. Talagang...
Saka fad,
yeah, go ahead, Carlo. Yeah.
Fads, dito rin papasok ulit yung sinabi kong empathy. Eh. Just because hindi ka nawalan ng trabaho or hindi ka namatayan ng family member, it shouldn't stop you from working as a leader towards that goal. Na isipin mo, ilan yun na wala ng trabaho, ilan yung businesses na nag-shut. So, marami sa atin hindi naapektuhan eh. Di ba? Pero that's where empathy comes in. Na hindi tayo, we don't live in a bubble.
I'll give our viewers a very concrete example of nahirapan ako in terms of policy and then morality. So, one of my big advocacies is that the Philippines, especially during COVID, should really borrow more money so that it can spend for its people. All modern economies run on debt. Hindi tayo magkakaroon ng debt zero. So ang issue lang is yung extent of debt. So tinignan ko yung list ng most indebted countries in the world. The Philippines is in the bottom third of that list. In other words, we are one of the least indebted countries in the world. And if you talk about, and if you listen to yung debates, and if you listen to our candidates, akala, kung magsalita, akala mo lahat may debt crisis at hindi na tayo pwede mangutang at a time when we need to really help our people. There was one candidate that said, you know, matipid ako sa pang-araw-araw, pero sa tingin ko, yung Pilipinas, hindi kailangan maging ganong katipid in terms of debt. Music to my ears. Kaso sinungaling yung kandidato. Nagpro-promote ng fake news. Hindi ko talaga kayang iboto. So, yun yung concrete example of why I can't go into policy dahil yung bare minimum hindi ma-fulfill.
No, that's a good well, dilemma that you shared, Leloy. Ah.
But ito yung problema. Ito yung problema, Leloy, because policy is not playing a very big role in alam mo, in general, I think. Just like, for example, Carlo, I don't think foreign policy has really entered much
into the
discussions. And anything that one would consider a serious policy discussion, medyo iniilagan ng karamihan ng mga kandidato. So what do you do in that absence where it's all just about feelings? Diba? I mean, sa akin, ang number one batayan ng marami sa ating mga kababayan, ads. And in 30 seconds, all an ad can do is feelings, di ba? And so, kung yun ang magiging batayan, should we totally I guess my question number one is, what is the role of feelings in this besides using your brain? Where does your heart enter into this picture? And second of all, why are we still talking about all these serious things kung most people will not be using those values anyway?
Mm-hmm.
Carlo, bakit ka pa bumoboto eh? Palagi naman talo yung manok mo. Diba? So, diba? I mean, it's a legitimate question.
It's a legitimate question. Because, well, it's part of our... It's one. Pinapatawa mo ako, no? But I keep voting because one, it's part of my responsibility as a citizen. I don't do it consciously na naghahanap ako nung laging underdog o ano. Kasi nga sabi ni Lelo, may hinahanap akong bare minimum na is does this person have the right character to be the leader of a democratic leader like ours. And makes now I'm thinking bakit nga ba nawala yung platforms yung policy sa ano natin sa usapan niyo kasi in 2016 hindi naman eh actually very upfront yung platforms from our current president alam ko pinupush niya yung federalism pero I think the past 6 years we were dominated by a personality heavy politics and one thing which I don't really look forward to but I think one thing on the flip side one positive thing it has done is it has brought the youth into the fold because when you're talking about personality politics you're talking about characters you're talking about more primal matters rather than specific policies, and this has captured the imagination of the youth, and it's a very good development. But now the question is, we're talking about journeys, diba? Father, journeys of hope, to eh. The journey doesn't stop with our casting of the ballot, because one thing Manolo has always emphasized in Proyekto Pilipino is that the youth vote has never been a factor in Philippine politics. Although it has driven issues and it is doing the same thing now. But the one thing I'm worried about is when the youth that is involved now, the results that come out is not favorable to them and they're disillusioned. What happens? And that's what I'm worried because I something that holds dear to me because when I went into government, I was hoping for a sort of mentorship. To someone older from the previous generations to bring me in the fold tell me ito yun dapat natin ginagawa but now ang tatanong ko father may nangyayari ba yan may ang simbahan ba kinakausap ang youth organizations ang all four of us no politicians are they reaching out to the youth in the event that after the elections they're trying to bring him into the fold of
well the church certainly has things coming up.
That's good.
Yeah. So and in fact we're in charge of that through NASA. And we're hoping that I'm looking at 3 consultants for that program right now. The youth political education program after the elections na no, because I already lined up. Ano, I already got into that group. Si Professor ano Arugay, si Arj Aguirre, and then kahit si ano, the one in Octa, si Dr. Guido David agreed also to become part of the group. And Tihanki said he's willing to help also. No, for that political education, I think the church has to play that role after the elections, and. Sabi ko nga sa simbahan, you know, I hope the day will come that come election time, hindi tayo nangangarag to come up with the voters education program. Di ba? Every election na lang yan, lagi yung problema yung voters education program na yun ng simbahan, di ba? So hopefully, Carlo, just, ano, hopefully the thing will fly with the church. Hopefully.
Well, you know, Father, the church has to have the attitude of the politicians, which is the campaign begins the day after election day.
That's I'm with you there. And I think a lot of bishops also realize that we do need to move that way. Okay, closing words of wisdom in terms of making a choice.
I'm not sure about words of wisdom, but sa akin practical perspective, the way we have to look at our journey of voting our leaders, parang ano yan eh. When it's Mayo, summer season, gusto mo ng beach body. Hindi ka pwedeng mag-diet in the last 2 weeks. Expect mo maganda na yung katawan mo. Dapat pinaplano mo yan. 6 years before pumunta ka sa beach.
Are you speaking from experience, Carlo?
Yes. But seriously, bago hindi lang naman yung pagboto yung importante kasi bago tayo dumating sa Mayo sa May 9 kailangan involve tayo sa community natin pinag-aaralan natin yung politika natin kung sino yung mga leaders natin and then on May 9 dapat effortless na yan kasi pinag-aaralan na natin yan.
Okay, thank you Carlo. Manolo or Leloy?
Sa akin simple lang, huwag kalimutan magdala ng kotigo pagboto para malinaw kung sino na yung pinag-isipan mo at talagang mabigay mo sa kanila yung boto mo.
I was gonna say to our viewers, binge watch nyo na lang ang episodes ng Proyekto Pilipino. Tulungan kayo. Pero magagalit si Carlo kasi equivalent yun ng crash dieting. Eh.
Baka gumana.
There's no such thing as a crash diet for politics, but Proyekto Pilipino is the closest thing.
Closest. Hindi lang closest, Leloy. Closest and effective.
Ayun.
Bago
tayo magtulog sa Asian Father, gusto ko sabihin, actually, have conversations. That's what I really want.
In this remaining week, carry conversation. And carry conversation, di ba, with the people you look up to. Yung pinaniniwalaan mo. So maraming salamat, Carlo, Leloy, Manolo. Thank you very much for this episode. And next week, abangan nyo, meron din kami ulit. Next week naman kasi, ang tatanungin ko mga celebrities. Not that you're not celebrities, but next week naman ang magsishare in their process of choosing, mga celebrities naman. So thank you very much and maraming salamat to all our viewers in Journeys of Hope. Mga kapamilya, maraming salamat. And again, mag-usap-usap, magpasya, at tandaan, maganda yung tip ni Manolo, gumawa ng kodigo para walang pagkakamali. Thank you very much.
Suriin, alamin, tumindig. This is Father Tito Caluag.
This is Manolo Quezon.
This is Leloy Claudio.
This is Carlo Santiago.
And you're listening to Proyekto Pilipino. Conversations on civics and politics.
As we prepare for the upcoming 2022 elections, we will dive deep into the roles and responsibilities of the candidates that we will elect.
And our own rights and obligations as citizens. So we can be better armed to make informed decisions for our country. Bakit ang baba ng requirements ng pagtakbo bilang presidente?
Ano ba talaga ang role ng vice presidente bukod sa pagiging spare tire kapag namatay o na-impeach ang presidente?
What makes a party list a party list? What is the role of the media in the elections?
Tara, makilahok at pag-usapan natin ang demokratikong proyekto ng Pilipinas.